Good afternoon, everyone. It's Tim Ostendorf back again with more things all Joan Sutherland. Actually, it's going to be all things all sorts of people today, because I am going to be doing a comparison of the same aria from Linda de Chamonix by six different sopranos, if I can get through it all. And so, in honor of that, I have my martini with six olives, one for each soprano. And of course, we're going to start with Joan Sutherland. But before, you may be wondering why I'm wearing this same lovely Italian shirt that I wore in one of my last videos, and what the heck I'm wearing with it. I have this lovely vintage dressing gown, not quite a smoking jacket, and I don't smoke anyway, so. I thought it just went very well, and then it dawned on me that it needed something else, and so I thought I'd try to see if I can still tie a bow tie. And quite a few years ago, a few years after college, back in the early 90s, I was in a production of A Quiet Place over at Lowell House Opera at Harvard, and I played the doctor in the first scene. It's a wonderful opera by Bernstein, and he took his earlier one-act opera, Trouble in Tahiti, and sort of morphed it into a full three-act opera. Maybe it's only two acts, but I'm pretty sure it's three acts. And I played the doctor in the first act that took care of Dinah, who's actually not in the first act because she's dead. Actually, you see her in flashbacks. Anyway, and I had to tie a bow tie every night, and I've since tied a bow tie, but it's been... I know, there's a joke in there about tied one on or whatever, but anyway. But I haven't tied one in a couple years, because as an innkeeper, did I mention baritone innkeeper Tim Ostendorf? I probably did, I hope so, for those of you tuning in. The funny thing is, I found this dark purple paisley tie, and it is the actual bow tie that I wore all those years ago in that Lowell House Opera production of A Quiet Place. So I thought it was kind of interesting to see if I could still tie it after all these years, and I thought the color went perfectly with the shirt and the dressing gown, and anyway, seek out that opera. There's not a lot of recordings of it because it's not done that often, but there is at least one recording, and let's see. I just got to straighten it out a little, but not too bad, huh? What do you think? Well, it's a little off kilter, but you know, I'll fix it. It's all good. Anyway, so what we're going to listen to is Joan Sutherland. That's why. Oh, you little bugger. There you are. Oh, found it. That makes more sense. There we go. That's a little better. Still a little off kilter, but I'll continue to fiddle with it. Linda de Chamonix by Donizetti, very popular aria. The opera itself isn't done very often, and it's got a kind of convoluted plot, big surprise, right? And, it's getting there. It's set in Chamonix, in the French Alps, and the character Linda, the lead female, of course, is in love with Carlo, who's a penniless painter, but we find out later he's really a count or some sort of something like that. Of course, they're in love and all that, and they travel to Paris and back, and she finds out she doesn't know that he really has money and all this other stuff, and then she loses her reason. She goes crazy, but they get back together at the end. And so we're going to start out with Joan Sutherland, of course, and if I keep looking over here, it's because I have the music. I like to follow along because it's one of those arias from the bel canto period where they add lots of ornamentation and things that are not written on the page. And so hopefully we'll talk about that as we go through the different sopranos singing this lovely aria, and it starts with a recitative, Ah, tardi troppo. I was tardi, tardi. I was tardi too much, troppo. And to get to our favorite meeting place, and because my dear Carlo is not here. And so here is Joan Sutherland from 1959, her first big solo recital recording. It's got the two big scenes from Lucia de Lammermoor. It was right after her big success as Lucia that this recording came out. She had done there had been some live recordings floating around, but this was it's a wonderful. I know I've mentioned it before, but let's get to the music. Let's see. As you know, she's Australian, and she was 33 when this recording was made. And I just did a little research, just as a bit of interesting history on how old each soprano was when they recorded this. No particular reason, just for fun. And I love that opening. It's just sprightly and wonderful. I think it's Nello Santi who conducted this. This was before Richard Bonning, her husband, conducted most of her performances and recordings. And it just has a light freshness to it, just even in that opening orchestral part before she even starts singing. And she has this wonderful, winsome quality to her voice. And, you know, she's kind of sad. She's in love with somebody. She got there too late to meet him, but some flowers were left for her. And then she's going to sing about how happy she is. And nobody knows how much he has suffered, but not as much as I, she says, sofferto, suffering, ma non al par di me, but not as much as I. A flat, just below high C, just the way she, it's like it's nothing. An A flat, nothing. And hopefully you can hear that her diction, I think, is great this early on. But she just said, in love and in hope, and he's an unknown painter, but by his talenti, soon he'll be well known. And, of course, we know that he's really not an untalented painter. He's not even a painter. He's a very rich person. But anyway, my point was about the diction, and I think it's quite clear overall. To the B flat. And that's obviously not written. It's a little mini cadenza where she goes up to a high note on the word contenti. We will be happy, content. And you'll hear that tune. That's the tune. O luce di quest'anima. Here's the little cavatina. O light of my soul, o luce di quest'anima. And so far, she's pretty much, except for that one little cadenza that I mentioned, singing it pretty much as written, as the score is shown. But then she starts to ornament a little. And of course, not surprisingly, when we hear Beverly Sills, she'll be one of the ones that ornaments the most. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later. Little trill. All not written, a little cadenza. There's actually a cadenza written in the score, but it was quite often, of course, in the bel canto period. That was sort of a guideline, and from that you would tailor it to whatever worked for you and add another high note or not or whatever. And back to the... Oh. Here we go. Hopefully you can hear these variations. Nice full-throated D-flat held almost to the very, very end, which of course it's not supposed to be, and she, as most of those sopranos do, they just keep holding it while the orchestra keeps playing. So of course, Joan Sutherland, at the age of 33, singing O Luce di Quest'anima with the recitative in Cavaletta, very well-known aria from a not very well-known opera. And I have six different sopranos that we're going to hear today. Six olives, six sopranos. Signing off for the moment, Timothy Ostendorf, baritone innkeeper in acrystallake.com in Eaton, New Hampshire. And we'll see you back here for my next conversation about my next soprano. Who will it be? Who will it be? I wonder who it will be.